All right, last part. We're in the final stretch here. Remember how we talked about the sympathetic nervous system and how we've got the sympathetic nervous system, got the parasympathetic nervous system, both of which are a part of the autonomic nervous system. Sympathetic is the gas, parasympathetic is the brake. So far, we've been talking about ways to press down the accelerator. There's other things that we can do that take off the brake, and remember, they work together. So if you take off the brake, you make it easier to accelerate, to get the sympathetic going. So how can we get rid of the parasympathetic nervous system so that we're focusing predominantly on our sympathetic, and that's what we've got running? The parasympathetic nervous system, the chemical mediator that runs the parasympathetic nervous system, the chemical that our body produces and squirts out into our bloodstream to say, let's get the parasympathetic system going, is a drug called, a neurotransmitter called acetylcholine. So acetylcholine is produced in our body, and when receptors throughout the body receive acetylcholine, that's the message telling them it's time to rest and digest, it's time to relax. So you have here acetylcholine, ACH is the short form for it, and here's the cell, and we have these acetylcholine receptors, and the short term for that is cholinergic receptors. So when acetylcholine comes and knocks on the door, or rings the doorbell, ding dong, poof, we get the magic going on inside the cells for our cholinergic activity, our parasympathetic activity of some sort. So what's the parasympathetic activity that happens? Let's look first of all in the lungs. So inside the lungs, we've got cells with cholinergic receptors on them. And when those cells are stimulated, they start doing parasympathetic rest and digest type stuff inside the lungs. And what would that be? The way I remember that, what the parasympathetic nervous system does, is to think about a dishwasher. I know it's weird, but this is how I think. So imagine it's the end of the day, the hurly-burly of the day is over, it's time for you to be cleaning up, you take all your dishes, and what do? You put them in the dishwasher. And then you close up the dishwasher, press the button, turn it on, and when you turn it on, all the water goes in, it picks up all the crap and the residue that are in the dishwasher, jumping ahead of myself, cleans off all the dishes in the dishwasher. You've got this water now that's filled with junk and dirt and food. And what do you do with it? You flush it out of the dishwasher, and then what's left inside the dishwasher is clean. The dishes and the dishwasher itself are clean. That's what the parasympathetic nervous system does in the lungs. So when the cells in the lung get the acetylcholine hitting the cholinergic receptor, they say, time to run the dishwasher. So they shut down the bronchioles, the airways inside the lungs, and get them smaller. Those bronchioles are muscular, so they can dilate and constrict. So they constrict down a little bit, bronchoconstriction, and the lungs produce a lot of mucus from our goblet cells. And that's where, that might even be where we get the word gob from. I don't know. But all this gob, all this mucus comes out and soaks through the lungs, picks up the pollution and the smoke and the particulate matter and the dust and whatever else we've been breathing in during the day. We breathe in pollution, and it absorbs it into the mucus, picks it up, and then we start to wash it out. So inside of our airways, we've got little cilia, and those cilia are like little hairs, and if you've got dirt in there, it just kind of brings it up. And if we're sleeping and this happens, then often we'll just swallow whatever comes up. Or if you're a smoker, you wake up in the morning, if you know a smoker, you wake up in the morning and you know they're going, and they're clearing out their lungs. The lungs have been running the dishwasher all night because it's been parasympathetically innervated. We've had acetylcholine stimulating the lungs into the parasympathetic system and washing out the lungs, and now they're just getting rid of all the crap. It's like the exhaust coming out of the dishwasher with all the effluent that's in there and all the crap. So that's how we clean out our lungs. Let's talk about asthma and what happens when a person's having an asthma attack. When we take a look at the bronchioles, here's, let's just say, an airway. These are actually muscular airways. There's a muscle around the outside. And people who have asthma, chronic respiratory disease, these muscles actually get a lot bigger. And in the process of getting bigger, you find that the airway lumen, the lumen is the hole on the inside, actually shrinks a little bit. And when these things constrict, they constrict more than a normal lung would. So we've got a bit of a small lumen. Another thing that happens in asthma concurrently is that you get inflammation on the inside of the airways, and that inflammation lessens the lumen even more. The third thing you get, the triple whammy, is that you get a whole bunch of mucus produced inside there. More mucus than you normally get. And now, instead of having a nice big lumen, you're down to a relatively small space, and that's an asthma attack. What can we do about asthma? Well, one thing that we've already talked about you can do is that you can use a beta-2 agonist. And the beta-2 agonist controls the musculature of the bronchial. So it helps the bronchial dilate a little bit, because that's what the stimulation does. But we've still got the problem of a bit of inflammation. And we've talked about mast cells and how mast cells are those landmines that set off all the inflammatory mediators. So in our bronchial here, with a little bit of beta-2 agonist, we open it up and we help decrease the inflammation a little bit, but we've still got all this mucus. If the dishwasher's running, that's the last thing we want to have happen in an asthma attack. So the last thing we want when someone's having an asthma attack is to have any sort of parasympathetic activity or innervation at all. So if there was a way we could turn off the parasympathetic nervous system, that would be perfect. So how can we do that? Well, we actually have a drug that does that. And the drug is called ipratropium bromide, often called atrovent. And what atrovent does is it goes into the lungs and goes through the body, but in the lungs is where we care. So it goes in and it blocks off those cholinergic receptors. So when the acetylcholine comes and tries to ring the doorbell to start the dishwasher, the signal to the cell that it's time to go parasympathetic, then the atrovent goes, nope, can't do it, sorry, not going to let you press the button. So we don't get more mucus production and we don't get a constriction of the bronchioles, which is perfect. It's exactly what we want. So we'll give a little bit of atrovent, and that'll help with the lungs to make sure that we're not getting bronchospasm and mucus plugging. But there's another place that we can use a cholinergic blocker as well. So this is our atrovent, our cholinergic blocker in the lung. The other place that we can block acetylcholine from turning on the parasympathetic nervous system is in the heart. I'm going to draw a not entirely normal diagram of the heart. Let's just call that your heart. There's the right atrium, there's the left atrium, right ventricle, left ventricle. Our heart, we've already talked about one of the ways to press the gas on the heart, and that's to use a beta-1 agonist. And the beta-1 agonist will stimulate the sympathetic nervous system, and the sympathetic nervous system will increase the activity of both the atria and the ventricles. So if we want to get the heart to speed up, giving it a beta-1 agonist, we'll get it going in both the atria and the ventricles. The heart has another system on it, though. The heart has a nerve that runs from the brain down just to the atria, not to the ventricles, just to the atria. And this nerve is called the vagus nerve. The vagus nerve is huge, 10th cranial nerve. It goes all through the body. In fact, vagus is Latin for wandering. What the early anatomists realized is that this nerve just goes everywhere throughout the body. And so they called it the wandering nerve, the vagus nerve. And that's where we get the term vagus from. So when the vagus nerve comes down here and it wants to stimulate the heart, it goes and it spits out acetylcholine. The acetylcholine floats around to the cholinergic receptors only in the atria, because there aren't cholinergic receptors in the ventricle. And if there's a very fast heart rate going on that's being generated from the SA node in the right atrium, the sinoatrial node, then the acetylcholine will slow it down. So this is like a brake, like a parking brake that you have in a car. It's a parking brake on the heart. So if the heart's going too fast, one of the things we can do is try to stimulate the vagus nerve. And there's a bunch of ways that we can stimulate the vagus nerve. Because it goes all through our body, we don't have to stimulate it by somehow getting into our heart. It passes down through our neck and actually rubbing on an area of our neck, well, pressing and then letting go, at a place called the carotid sinus. We call it carotid sinus massage. Don't do this yourself if you're not a paramedic or a medical professional, because you can screw yourself up. So don't go playing with this. But if you're a paramedic or a medical professional, then doing carotid sinus massage is actually one of the ways you can manually slow down your heart. You can also do direct ocular pressure, but that's not a good idea either. We used to recommend that. We don't anymore. There's all sorts of bizarre things that will stimulate our vagus nerve to slow down. Cold water facial immersion works really well. And if you've ever been through a pediatric hospital, you'll sometimes see kids sitting there with a bag of ice on their face. And what that's doing is stimulating their vagal nerve to slow down the heart rate. Holding your breath and going, and really bearing down, it's a vagal maneuver, and it slows down, it hits the vagus nerves and basically puts the brake on the heart. Which is why, if you're lifting weights or doing a lot of exertion, they say don't hold your breath when you're doing an exertion. If you want to, you can go onto YouTube. There's all sorts of videos of guys, usually young men, taking a weight and lifting up and going, boom, and down they go. And the reason they go down, actually, I kind of did it myself. I can feel I'm a bit lightheaded because I vagaled myself. But by holding that intrathoracic pressure and transmitting it up into my neck, it stimulates the vagus nerve, which goes, puts the parking brake on the heart. My heart slows down, and I get decreased perfusion in my brain, and I pass out. Not a good idea. Another time that this happens is with people. We see this all the time as paramedics. People who sit down on the toilet, and they're straining, and they're straining, and straining to have a bowel movement, and boom, down they go. And they almost collapse in that tiny little space between the toilet and the bathtub, and they're just stuck in there. So that gets us. I did a call once. Oh, I should talk about that. Well, a digital circumferential rectal sweep of the anal sphincter is a vagal maneuver. We're quite vagally innervated down in our pelvis. So you can imagine what was going on with this couple. They were trying something new, and she passed right out. And why? Because she'd been vagaled rectally. It also happens to guys, too. If we're punched in the stomach or if guys are hit in the groin, then that stimulates the vagus nerve as well. And any guy who's been bagged knows that you start feeling nauseous and you start feeling lightheaded and you start feeling dizzy. Why? Because it stimulates the vagus nerve. And one of the things the vagus nerve does is put the parking brake on the heart. Your heart rate slows down. Boom, down you go. So this is like all over the place. The vagus nerve is actually really, really an interesting thing that happens in the heart. So let's say, for example, your heart, instead of going too fast, is going too slow. And we walk up and we see somebody and they're lying on the bed and they're all, maybe they've had some vagal stimulation or something, we don't know what, but they got a heart rate of like 40 or 30 and they're really dizzy and they can't sit up and they've got a low blood pressure. And we think, oh boy. I can put the gas down, which is giving them some adrenaline, but that's a pretty big kick in the heart. And that's also going to have alpha-1 effects and beta-2. Beta-2 is not so bad, but I'm going to, you know, maybe spike their blood pressure. I'm going to be kicking their heart to get it working. Let's see if I can do something a little bit more gentle. Let me just try taking off the brake first. So we give a drug intravenously, and the drug is called atropine. And atropine basically blocks this system so that the acetylcholine can't get in and can't do its work, so the vagus nerve is essentially cut off from access to the heart, and the atropine blocks off the vagus nerve, and the heart can start to pick its heart rate back up again. So that's a great tool for us to have. Having atropine to use, atropine is like the atrovent of the heart. And the way to remember them, of course, is atrovent helps you with your ventilation. And atropine is the other one. So that's a little bit about what the cholinergic does there and how using anticholinergics work inside the lungs and how anticholinergic works inside the heart. So the review we've done is essentially the central nervous system. We've talked a little bit about how GABA is enhanced, the neurotransmitter that relaxes the system, GABA is enhanced by using a benzodiazepine. That's in our brains, the central nervous system. We've talked a little bit about the sympathetic nervous system, the gas pedal of the body, and how we can use drugs to turn on alpha 1, beta 1, and beta 2 receptors, and how they have different effects. And then we talked about the parasympathetic nervous system, the brake on the body, which we try to take off. And specifically, we talked about the brake to our lungs, which we use atrovent to get rid of, to take off. And we talked about the brake to our heart, which we use atropine to get rid of. Hopefully that helps you out and gives you a bit of an idea of some of these drugs that we use and why we use them. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments here, and I'm happy to answer them. Thanks for watching. I hope it helped.